And welcome back to more... bumping into people. To more... Torment, Tides of Numenera. Whoops. Flying around here. Arms merchant. Oh, what do we got here? Armors of wildly different materials are arrayed neatly within the stall. The sign over this stall says, "The Arming Room. Buy, sell, trade." Under the awning, a skinny man with stooped shoulders and a concave chest is cleaning a filth-caked weapon of some kind. He salutes you with a greasy hand. Done in a moment. Have a look around. If you need anything, let me know. What can you tell me about Sega's Cliffs? Good place for the arms trade. Not much call for weapons in the city proper. It's true. The Levies keep things quiet. He shrugs. I get most of my business from mercenary companies. The endless battle draws them by the dozens. Explorers, too. Plenty of carkers save up their shins and kit themselves out, all fancy-like. Then they wander down the reef or into the bloom and never come back. Show me what you have for sale. So I'm not going to buy anything. A dagger. A well-used, carefully honed dagger. One of the simplest weapons available, but in the right hands also one of the most lethally quick. Rapier. This slim, sharp sword requires greater precision than a broadsword, but is utterly lethal in the right hands. A decorative hilt protects the wielder's hands. Broadsword. This typical sword has a few notches, scars earned from long years of use. A bird? Oh, look at that. This weapon resembles a sword with two forked blades. It is shorter than an ordinary sword. Its unique shape makes it useful for both offense and defense. Almost looks like a pair of... like a big pair of scissors. Regular mace. This mace has a slender haft attached to a heavy flanged head that can tear into heavy armor. Maces are cheap, common, and easy to create. Great sword. Large, heavy, and sharp, this enormous blade is truly deadly. It requires two hands to use. Shield, we've looked at that before. We've come across a shield before. Crossbow. This is a basic crossbow, a bow assembly mounted horizontally on a wooden stock. It's slower than an ordinary bow, but has great accuracy. Concussive truncheon. Halt, knave, or I'll use my truncheon. Okay. Critical hits confer stern. Character cannot move or take actions for one round. This weapon releases a pulse of disorienting energy when striking the enemy's more vulnerable parts. Battle axe. With a nasty spike on the back and a fine polished edge on the front, this axe is light enough to be used with one hand, but still heavy enough to do serious damage. And a broadsword, yeah. Don't need any of this stuff, sorry. What? The Genocide? Oh boy. Hello, the Genocide. This burly, armor-clad figure stands almost motionless as you approach. He regards you silently through his singular eye. Oh, like a cyclops. I wasn't aware that was an eye. Right there. Boop. The studs on his arms and the blades on his shoulders are stained and pitted with age. When he speaks, his voice is muffled and artificial, a hollow grumble that emanates from the entirety of his helmet. I am the Genocide. If you ask, I must answer. Pass on, then, and exchange no words. Well, I want to ask so that you must answer. His surface thoughts are like a crystal pool, alternately transparent or else perfectly reflecting his words. His mind reveals nothing hidden, except for a low-level hatred of everything around him. The latter is more a feeling you get than the actual thought that you hear. You said you had to answer if I asked. Why? From within the helmet you hear a grinding noise, the sound of teeth gnashing, amplified. Then the voice again, bleak. We sat at the river's edge, and we wept for the time that was. We saw nothing more to conquer, and yet our fears still drove us. We had conquered the land, purged its impurities, made it ours. Still, we wanted more. When we heard that humans had come to carve a home, we rejoiced to have a new foe, a new test of our truth. We rode against them. Oh my. We drove them to the forge of the night sky, to the valley of Emra, Jolios, to the dangers of the Black Riage. But those who built atop these ruins, they thwarted us, time and again. And so we brought our constructs and our deadliest warriors to the bay outside the city. We laid a mighty siege. We entered the human settlement. We fought past barricades and traps. Some of our constructs are still there, silent and dead. But when we thought we had achieved our greatest victory... He lowers his head. A powerful nano saved them. With his magics, he called upon the strength of the ancients and captured us. I thought my life was at an end, but he imprisoned me in slow time, trapped me in my body, used machines to paralyze my will. I still remember our glories, and I see the faded future in front of me, and I am powerless to act. The memories of our triumphs remain always at the forefront of my mind, and I must answer the mocking questions of these people, or suffer. What are you? I am a blade that cannot cut, a weapon that cannot strike, a living monument to failure. He shifts his weight. You hear the frown in his voice. I was Orgesti, Tel Kotu, the firm hand of tradition. They called me one of the Black Three. Enemies did not understand us. They took my name to mean death in a dozen extinct tongues, called me Orphan Maker, Hope Smasher, Death's Child. My armies blackened the earth and the skies. My Dragoliths scoured the land. Domination was my duty. If they had known, if they had welcomed us, they might have been our thralls. Instead, they became dust. He gestures. All this, it was to have been mine in stewardship for the future of my people. It was promised, but now... His arm falls back to his side. Now I am the Genocide, a relic. A relict. The last of my kind. Oh. It's a bot? I don't remember saying that. You said you were the last of your kind. Why? I know of no others. Kalagat Anvor, he who shares truth and understanding, is dead. Vastila Lo, the blinding light of reason, was destroyed. The underspine has fallen. My people are destroyed utterly, and our servant God speaks to us no longer. The clean lines of order and the glory of battle have forsaken us. He pauses. The rest are dust. We rose against a superior foe, and were outmatched. Only I remain to tell the story of the Tabat. Well, now I hear about the Tabat. Can you tell me about the nano who trapped you here? How did he stop you? The Genocide raises his hands in defeat. He found old knowledge and made it his own. He created defenses that we could not penetrate. Most telling, most effective, the shield generators. He created three barriers around the heart of the city, and the last unmoored the city in time. When our constructs touched it, they flashed to stasis. We could not reach the city, but the city could reach us. You feel the ticklings of memory as the Genocide speaks of the shields. He continues to talk, oblivious. Let the memory come. It's a patchy memory, coming in still images and moments. The relentless beat of the war machines as they approach the city, the reavers in the sky on their dirigibles. Now this reminds me of, Pillars of Eternity. When you, reach out and you can get the memories from someone's soul. Of course, this is our memory, I guess our memory from the Changing God. You remember fighting them on the parapet. You remember fleeing into the safety of the city. You recall making your way to the shield generators, cutting off the Tabat supply lines. And then the memory fades. The Genocide watches you silently. Yeah, I might have missed what he said, so let me hear that again. Huh, the nano. I am not required to speak of him again to you. The compulsion has been satisfied. So we can't repeat things. Can you tell me what you are again? Ogesti Telkotu. A mockery they call the genocide. A living relict of the Tabat. He does not seem inclined to elaborate further. You seem very calm for someone who's been imprisoned for centuries. I have been defeated. I have nothing to fight for. My captor castrated me with a tool they made to dampen my natural urges. I can remember the actions. I can recall the glory. But I feel shame, regret. I am weakened, but not by my volition. The genocide squeezes his fists. What does it matter? Those who stood against me are all dead. I am victorious. I no longer fight with a blade. My weapon is time. He leans in closer. I do not die. I cannot be wounded. I am held like a beetle in sap. Why would I not be serene? He settles back. The underspine spoke of my destiny. I was to wage war unto the edge of the universe, but the universe keeps going, and so it seems must I. Some day I will be free. Some day. Until then, I am incorruptible. Oh, he was? The nano is a changing god. How did they stop you from trying to escape? The nano who raised the city's shields created a device. He called it the Mind Seer. With it, he violated my mind, my memories, and everything that was at the core of my being. In a fit of vengeance, he tore truths from me. He made me betray my people. He rewrote my mind. He gave me the perfect clarity into the past and gilded my ability to shape the future. The Tabat never sought revenge against foes who were mightier than we. We devised stratagems to defeat them. We tested ourselves. We did not punish or hate. Punishment was purification. This, though, is torture. The worst of the city's refuse can mock me now. They can ridicule and jape, and I am powerless to strike them for their impudence. Then, quieter. And now they do not even do that. I have become a fixture, an irrelevance, a non-entity. I am the slave, too. You hear his teeth grinding as he thinks of the perfect insult. To peacemakers. I must endure their presence and feel their corruption sink into me daily. Some foreign part of me desires it. He thumps his fist into his hand, but I remember that I will triumph over them. Eventually, they will die, and I will not. The nano who defeated you was the changing god. He and his children still live. His voice is flat and dead. Others have claimed this. I do not know if they say this to torment me, but if our enemy was a god, even if he was once but a man, then to stand against him is to spit into the face of the divine. But the Tabat were a holy people. Humans do not believe it, but our rights were as sacred to us as they were profane to your kind. We accepted the will of the ineffable. Any who still may live may yet find the mantle of godhood. To be divine is to be beyond the rule of mortal ethics. Those who would be gods must cast aside these concerns if they are to turn against the old teachings. You mentioned the Tabat. Who or what were they? My people. His voice is forlorn. Great warriors. We owned this land. We served the Underspine, and it served us. We sought truth and victory. We ascended to epiphany. We were pure, incorruptible, indivisible, even in disunity. We found strength in one another, and proved it with bloody blades. But we fell, and the Underspine fell. And so, too late, we learned a new truth. But I carry the old ways as a seed within my heart. Why did the Tabat fight so much? For honor, for truth, for the one way. Because it was our duty. We were born to the blade. So it was written. So we chose. Free will is a curse unless given to a greater purpose. Our purpose was given to us by the Underspine, given to the Underspine by our ancestors who found it and crystallized our essence forever. You mentioned the names of some Tabat. Can you tell me about them? Kalagat Anvor, the strongest mind of the Black Three. None could stand before him when he bent his mind to their unraveling. Intricate, careful, overwhelming. Vastulat Lo, a methodical planner, collector of curiosities, the toolsmith and construct maker. Construct waker, sorry. It was he who brought the ancient machines to life, and I, the knife, the strategist, the blade in their hands, we three were unstoppable. He pauses. Until Sega's cliffs. Until then. Until the corruption of defeat. So wait, can you tell me where the other Tabat are again? The rest of the Tabat have gone to the dust. Only I remain. Can you tell me more about the Underspine? Our slave, our god, our prize. It kept us holy, kept us pure and unchanging, anchored to a fixed point. The world turned around us, but we remained constant. When the world brought inconstancy, we fed it blood. He pauses. The Underspine was our soul, a confessor. We knew clean, hard rapture from it. We knew our path. It gave us the words of the ancient Tabat, and our path was rigid and unbending, absolute. But what was the Underspine? He considers. You would not understand. It was a machine. It was a stone. It was a cavern. It was a city. It was the direct voice of our ancestors. It spoke in our heads, and in our ears, and in our hearts. We heard its voice in our creches, in our daily instructions. Our God was true and strong and singular, not the fickle and constant things of the modern day. What's the benefit of an absolute path? We had no questions about our duty, about our goals, only the particulars. We erased doubts in the purity of utter certainty. Questions raised are questions answered, or they are heresy. No need for self-agony. The necessity of introspection was transmuted into optimization of our paths, into fashioning ourselves into the pinnacle of our achievement. Clear definition in life creates truth, not this pitiful shadow. What happened to the Underspine? You can hear the frown in his voice. Sabotage. Or failure. One of those under my command told me it had whispered defeat into his ears, as if it had sickened, lost sight of the true path. Given the question, the Underspine denied this. My soldier was cast out, and I suffered the barb for his doubt. It was later, years later, that the Underspine broke, after a failure. And I have never been sure if the seeds of our defeat were planted in those days. He shuffles his feet. The Nano who captured me, who nailed me to time, he used the Mind Seer to ferret out the Underspine's location. I do not know if he ever found it in the world. He raped a genocide from me and mocked me with his sobriquet. I was not to blame. I will stand before the Underspine and swear my innocence. Should I say this? If your path was unbending, it's no wonder you broke. Ooh, my red tide went up. First time, small amount. Not a tiny amount. I do not bend now. I have been driven down, but I do not bend. I live, and those stood me against me are dead. He turns away from you slightly. Do you have more questions, or do you release me? You mentioned the shield generators. Can you tell me about them? I told you they're a fact. They unmoored the city in time. They severed our supply lines. They left us vulnerable and defeated us. The Underspine strategy failed us. I began to doubt. He shifts slightly. The generators are unused, abandoned, their purpose forgotten, though the people of the city still swear by our name, and our terrors are fresh in their nightmares, despite the passage of centuries. They have forgotten the means of their salvation. This one, beside me, no longer functions, but one of the others is buried in the ground, not far from here, and has not yet failed. It powers the clock around which these ridiculous fools prance. Okay. I have no more questions. Farewell. No. I wish you no good tidings. Okay, so this one's broken. This machine towers above you like a dagger driven into the ground by a giant. It seems much older than the surrounding buildings. Your hands itch to touch the array of dark panels scattered around the machine, as though they have touched them before. Let's examine the device. Your hands slip over the cobbled together components and greasy cables, the buttons worn by frequent use. It is a strange accomplishment, this machine. Clumsy but deft. Amateurish but masterful. Only a brilliant mind could have melded so many disparate parts into a functional device. Unfamiliar memories whisper to you. This device was used, though you don't know how, to generate a field that unmoored everything within it from time itself. Your fingers scrape a rough patch. Lifting them, you see a circinate symbol etched into the side, like a maker's mark. A tangle of mismatched parts make a tangle of mismatched parts make up this once functional generator. Once again, you notice the circinate symbol etched into the side like a maker's mark. Okay, so use anamnesis to try to remember why this machine feels so familiar. Failure? Oh. The memory teases you with images of the machine in pieces, but you can remember no more than that. Let's try again. You've fully depleted one of your stat pools. To recover your stat pools, you need to find a place to sleep or use consumable items and ciphers. Anyway, success. I might use one of those items, not sure. See how many I have. For my intellect. You close your eyes to better concentrate, sinking into the currents of a memory that does not belong to you, or at least not to the body you are in. And you hear the thunderous heartbeat of the operational generator calling you from across centuries. You open cold, focused eyes, ignoring the screams, the drifting tangles of black smoke. Your attention is solely focused on the health of the machine's heartbeat. You reach into the hissing guts of the generator, adjusting and tuning, hoping. The heartbeat fades into the past. Your hand, your body's hand, rests on the rusty surface of the long-dead generator. Alright. 3 points of intel. We only have one. I'm gonna go on without it for now.
Of course.
Ah, something here. A jumble of boulders and debris lies at the foot of the surrounding cliffside. The broken remains of ancient devices lie amongst the fallen stone, while off to one side a metallic canister sticks out of the top of the pile. It appears mostly intact. Let's examine the canister. Leaning over, you notice that the container is hollow, with an opening in the top providing full access to the interior. A quick glance reveals that it is empty. While most of the canister is relatively intact, a small part of it, its exterior wall, has been pried open, exposing delicate mechanisms. Let's scavenge what we can from the canister. Alright, we can do that. Using the pried open panel as a starting point, you delicately disassemble the exterior of the canister and manage to retrieve a fair number of intact components. We just gained 65 shins, nice. Examine the rocks. You notice a slight gleam as the light hits some of the rocks at just the right angle. You lean closer. Tiny mechanical devices are embedded in the rock. A quick search of the rest of the pile reveals that only a small percentage of the rocks are more than they appear. Let's smash the stones to extract what we can. That's an idea too, isn't it? Success! You gather up all the stones you can find with machinery close to their surface and set to work. Soon you have a tiny pile of components that should serve as shins. Just gained 72 more shins. Nice! Awesome.
now.
Yeah, too bad I didn't try putting the rocks in the thing. That really helps.
Yes, time. Now.
Yes, now. What's this? Small vandalist phrases are etched into the lower portions of these statues. Declarations of love, defamatory attacks, and announcements of localized existence whispering in stone from across the centuries. Okay, so we got performers here.
In an instant.
You're gonna love it in an instant, child. Hey, how did you do that? Ooh. I warn you, this next illusion may frighten you. Oh. I didn't mean to hit her. That's another Levy thing. Belazar? Oh, this is, yeah, more of the Nexthemeron thing. I remember this guy from the interactive trailer. This thin, fidgeting Aeon priest shoots furtive, sidelong glances at the creature in the nearby cage while humming a nonchalant tune. When he sees that you're watching him, he flinches. Over the course of a few frantic breaths, shock becomes embarrassed anger, and he opens his mouth to shout at you. And he thinks, there must be a way, but how? They never leave it alone. Yes? What is it? What is so goddamn fascinating about me that you feel the need to stare? What do you know about that creature over there? What? He says, jumping. Then he takes a breath and struggles to sound offhand. It's an Nexthemeron, a biomechanical creature. An information gatherer, in fact. He seems to calm down as he warms to the topic. They're dangerous, though. You can only speak to them at night. During daylight, they'll attack without provocation. A living repository of knowledge, Calistage murmurs, watching the creature. I wonder what places it has seen, what it knows. Belazar's eyes narrow suspiciously. You're planning something, aren't you? He weighs the intent of your words with narrowed eyes. Are you with the Order of Truth, or just snooping? This is interesting. I don't want to do this. I'm a friend of the Order. Maybe I can help you with whatever you're trying to do. We don't have much. Nope, fail. He looks you up and down. You're no friend to the Order. And I'm not planning anything. I'm enjoying the fresh air. Calistus smirks. He's up to something, she whispers to you. It's his nature. We should go to the Order of Truth and ask Min what's going on here. You seem nervous. I'm not, Belazar says, his eyes stealing to the cage creature again. I just don't like it when people sneak up on me. They gather information and display mindless hostility during the day. You can only reason with them at night. No one knows why. Well, we failed in that deception. But we can go ask at the Order of Truth. I wonder if that's the Order of Truth. We also have this square here.
We shall see.
Let's go up here. See what is up here.
In this world, then.
Yeah, this world would be a good idea. The energy trapped within the disks inset at the top of the pillars that line this wall appear to pulse slightly differently as people walk in front of them. What is this? The clock? Government Square? I don't want to leave the zone yet. I do want to find a place to sleep, though. I get these abilities back. Because I have basically nothing. What's this?
All right.
The structure is embedded in the ground. It was clearly not made by the same people who built Circus Minor. It looks as though this device extends deeper into the ground, below the road. Weathered runes are spread across the device's surface. I wonder if this is the other device that the Genocide was talking about. Oh, the Cult of the Changing God. Oh, greetings. Look, look, it's one of the Death Cheater's vessels. Ah, can it be? What fortune! What joy! Kazmin will want to see you, vessel. And Mimion, too. What? We have knowledge of all your brethren, Castoff. That is, all but a few. You've come to the right place. Of all your sire's cults, ours is the greatest, first and greatest. You should speak to Kazmin and Mimion, vessel. They're first among your sire's faithful.
On it.
I'm sure we're getting through there. This is an ancient device embedded in the ground. Weathered runes are etched into its surface. Will you let me touch you, honored vessel? Absolutely not. You've come to the right place here. The size of the human figure that's repeated throughout the camp is highly unusual. Its use as a symbol suggests the elevation of humanity, or perhaps a specific person.
Yes.
Another one of these things that we can't interact with. At least not yet. There's Mimion and Kazmin. I like your tattoo. Where'd you have it done? I gave all my fortune to the faith, every shin of my family's wealth. I was an outcast, hideous and shunned, before I found your sire's cult. I don't suppose you have a place I could sleep. Cool. Huh. Who's this? Who's this Philethis? I want to talk to this thing. A creature floats before you, hidden inside the bulk of its armor cloth robes. Unmoving and unmoved by your presence. Exactly who or what the thing is, man or machine, mutant or monster, is impossible to discern. Its glass face reveals nothing but your reflection. Its mechanical voice reveals nothing at all. I was not saying anything yet. You recall that this creature is known as a Philethis, but you don't know anything else about them. Exquisite, the Philethis grates, in greeting perhaps, or perhaps lost in its own inscrutable thoughts. The Philethis are said to have vast knowledge of the mysteries of the Ninth World and the Numenera of ages past, but prying these secrets loose can be a fool's errand. It reminds me of a Vorlon from Babylon 5. Tiber says, "Why, thank you." The Philethis does not acknowledge his quip or even his existence in any way. The creature's thoughts are obscure as its glass face. It's as though it weren't even there. Exquisite? No, the thing answers. It is not. For a moment that stretches uncomfortably, you feel the cold scrutiny of the Philethis upon you. At last, it speaks again. You ask, but the world rebukes. The Philethis's implacable glass gaze bores through your skin and sees more than others do, and it seems to be seeking something from you. This so seems like inspired by the Vorlons, guys. Persuasion. Tell me about yourself. Of course I have nothing to use. Nope. Failure. For a moment, the Philethis's face darkens. Then, without inflection, it answers. The cursed key hungers, and it feeds, but is denied satiation. Do you know anything about the sorrow? About the resonance chamber built by the changing god? Silence lingers long, until at last the Philethis speaks. I know it shall be three. I know the first cannot be trusted. I know one changes, as you change. I know they seek an undoing. Its glass face storms, but the Philethis says no more. What do you want from me? The Philethis ponders silently, until at last it asks, When you faced Korau, why did you not step first with your left foot? Balance, probably. The Philethis accepts her answer in silence, then after a long pause replies, In his vault, the Cloven One reads from his great book to his disciples. He sleeps, and awakens, and has forgotten his place in the grimoire. He begins anew. The book is a part of him. He has no legs and takes no steps. It is his own self from which he reads. It is his own self that is incomplete. It is his own self that binds him in the vault of his own mind. What more do you want from me? When the Philethis at last answers, its mechanical voice seems to creak. You did not accept your fall. When you have served the bitter root will you eat? I don't know. The Philethis is silent, showing neither satisfaction nor dismay at your response. You've been following me? In memory, cause follows effect. In rain, the colors run. A long rumble suggests that the Philethis has more to say, but nothing emerges. Do you have any more questions for me? Its words so rushed they almost jumble together. The Philethis asks, When you stood in the place of the shifting floors, which way did your shadow fall? I have no idea. Who's that guy? A long rumble echoes from inside the Philethis's robes, changing at last to words. In the village of Thome, it is written, The Eremite Elegizer descended deep into the darkness, for he cannot bear to see his shadow. Do you have still more questions? No. Why are you so interested in my choices? In its slow rumble, the Philethis replies, They are not yours. What do your questions mean? What do you want? Yes. The single flat word lingers in the air, until the Philethis adds, What is the answer? Perhaps the thing wants you to answer your own question. You want to understand why I have done what I have done. The Philethis accepts your answer silently, giving no clue as to what passes within its impervious robes, behind its impenetrable mask. At last the thing replies, The nose does not smell with words. Please, tell me about yourself in a way I can understand. No. Requires trained title affinity. Force it to tell it about itself. I don't have that. Farewell. As you step away, the Philethis swivels to keep its glass face trained upon you. Exquisite. Wow. Oh, that's that guy. Okay. So, tune back next time, guys. And with alacrity, we speak with Kazmin and Mimion of the Cult of the Changing God. And we check out whatever the hell this thing is. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.